Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is an evidence session on petition PE1490, Control of Wild Goose Numbers, which has been lodged by Patrick Crouse on behalf of the Scottish Crofting Federation. I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting Ray McKenzie, Policy and Operations Manager, Nature Scott, and Morag Milne, Wildlife Policy Officer, Nature Scott. Before we begin, and the first question will go to Finlay Carson, can I just ask for an update on where we are in terms of the five-yearly review into goose management in Scotland? If you could set the scene regarding that, please. Asking our witnesses, would Ray or Morag like to respond?
I can do that. So at the moment, we are in the middle of the five-year review. We started off doing a consultation with stakeholders, and that consultation period finished just under 2 weeks ago. So we had 257 responses to that consultation across most of the goose areas and apparently most of the goose stakeholders. It was an anonymous questionnaire, and so we're currently working through some of the information, or all of the information we've got back, and trying to look at where the kind of key areas and themes are in terms of what the stakeholders are looking for in goose policy going forward.
Thank you for that. And can you give an indication of when it might be completed?
The aim is to complete a report for the Minister by spring 2023. So what we're doing now, once we've got the theme sorted out in terms of what we've got back, we've got a lot of data to work through. We will go back to the local goose management groups and make sure that we've got the kind of the bulk of what they are saying to us correct, and write a draft report, and then pull that all together in a report for the Minister early in the new year.
That's helpful. Thank you for that. Can I go to Finlay Carson for his questions?
Thank you, Deputy Convener, and thank you for joining us this morning. Back in April, you responded to the committee's session we had with the petitioner. You noted that over the last 2 years that the shooting effort's probably been reduced because of COVID, and that might make it difficult to actually assess the impact on reducing goose numbers. But also, we've had the awful outbreak of avian flu. Can you tell me whether you're going to have to make predictions on future goose numbers, which might be affected by the COVID impact and shooting effort, but also potential reduced numbers of geese because of avian flu?
Who wants to take the question?
I'll take the avian flu question and then pass it to Morag for the COVID question, I think, because we're both working in slightly different areas. Avian influenza obviously has hit the Svalbard barnacle goose population in the Solway really, really hard. From early November last year through to March, it was estimated that 13,200 geese had died from a population of just under 40,000, so around a third of that population were lost. In other goose populations, the Greenland barnacle goose population, which is distributed around the west coast on Islay and into Ireland, it was estimated that around 2,700 birds had been lost to avian flu, 1,700 in Islay and 1,700 in Ireland, and around 1,000 on Islay. In terms of the other goose populations, greylags, there was cases recorded across the country, maybe around 60 or 70 cases, but no real concentrations of die-off. and with pink-footed goose much the same, apart from maybe a small concentration of die-off in Findhorn in the spring, just before they left to go north for migration. So in terms of what might happen, we're working with not an awful lot of information about how this might affect wild populations. This is absolutely unprecedented. Bird flu has circulated for quite a long time, but the scale of the impacts on geese and, as you'll be aware, on seabirds over the summer has been pretty significant in some places. So in terms of predicting what might happen, we've set up a framework of people who are out and about anyway doing various things, whether it be our nature reserve staff, RSPB wardens, bird observers in some places, to try and get an early warning of what's going on when birds come back and we can test and monitor. But because it's affected different populations in different ways, it's really, really difficult to predict what might happen. You know, we don't know why the Solway population was affected so badly. Yeah, the Greenland population, which are essentially the same geese, the Greenland barnacle population, weren't affected just as badly. And in the Solway, greylag and pinkfeet geese weren't affected in anywhere near the same scale. So it's pretty difficult to predict. And as geese are coming back from migration and we're pulling in count data, we'll have a better idea of what birds have made it to the breeding grounds and come back. And we'll be able to look at things over the next few weeks in terms of productivity and numbers coming back. So that's kind of where we are. And in terms of management, we're working with a task force of various agencies and a lot of expertise and pull together a plan going forward, a Scottish plan going forward, to try and better understand and manage the outbreak in wild birds. And I'll pass over to Maureen for the COVID question. She'll know more about the figures.
Maureen, do you want to pick that up?
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, in terms of COVID, it's very likely to have had a big impact on the number of birds taken through sport shooting. I can't tell you exactly how much because we don't have bag numbers coming in through sport shooting. But I can tell you that the number of greylag have recovered their numbers. Since 2017, their numbers have gone up at the sites where we regularly count them, the four adaptive management pilot sites, and the numbers recovered on the Western Isles since 2017. So that's likely to have been in part due to COVID and the reduced amount of shooting that has happened during the restrictions.
Thank you. Finlay, does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, that's a comprehensive answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move to Alistair Allen, please?
Thank you, Convener. It's interesting to hear what's just been said there about greylag goose numbers. As I live in the Isle of Lewis, I will declare a sort of an interest. Though I'm not a crofter, I am, where I live, surrounded by greylag geese. And surrounded by comment on them. So I wonder if you can say a bit more, just so the committee can have a picture of greylag goose numbers, what has changed about their migration patterns and about their numbers, and also about the impact that's had on agriculture, but particularly the kind of agriculture that actually supports wider habitats for a wider number of species.
Really want to start with that, or was Morag? Sorry, I'm finding it difficult working out who's doing what here.
Thank you. Yes, greylag numbers have increased substantially. The resident population of greylag numbers has increased substantially over the last 20-25 years, and in particular at certain sites. So, and that's because of the numbers increasing, and also the patterns of migration have changed, so that the numbers of migratory Icelandic grey-eyed geese that spend the winter with us have spent more of them have spent their winter on Orkney than in previous years. So over the last 20 or so years, we've had an increase in the numbers of grey lag throughout Scotland, and in particular some places.
Thank you, Ray. Do you want to add to that?
That we don't have systematic counts of resident grey lag across the country, and it does seem to be the resident grey lags that are causing most of the issues. The Icelandic grey lags come into Orkney and very north of Scotland, but on the islands it's very much resident grey lags. Their productivity is high. On the islands, they don't have too many natural predators, and there's probably something connected to things like climate change and so on that's kind of allowed them to breed incredibly well. So, you know, in terms of the numbers in the places where we're carrying out management, we've got a good idea of the overall numbers because we carry out counts in those places. But in the rest of Scotland, we don't, and they're increasing just about everywhere.
Alistair?
Just to follow up on that, I'm just keen to have your comments on the sort of, as I say, this impact on not just agriculture but the wider environment. My understanding from looking around me is that grey lag geese are pulling up, despoiling, if you like, areas of agricultural land. They're actually pulling up grass, but they're also making areas ungrazable, if that's a word, for a long time after they've collectively decided to visit. So I suppose my question is, if the method of controlling this, for the reasons that we're all talking about, both agricultural and environmental, is primarily going to be shooting, how do we address the fact that they're in communities where agriculture is part-time, how do we address the fact that we are going to need significant numbers of shooters to deal with this problem?
Ray, do you want to take that?
So that there is no dispute that geese cause serious agricultural damage, and in particular, as Ray has said, grey lags are a problem. And certainly, the main method for controlling resident grey lag geese has been through shooting. Some egg oiling takes place, but shooting is the main method. And on the Western Isles, where we've supported re-demonstration projects to see if it's possible to control resident grey lag birds, maintain their interest, their conservation interest, but also reduce agricultural damage. The traditional methods of shooting and egg oiling have been successful in reducing their numbers to about half over a short period, over a five-year demonstration project. That wasn't possible on Orkney. There, the numbers of resident grey lag birds are much higher. So to reduce their numbers, a greater number needed to be taken. And there was a shorter period within which to work, because to focus attention on taking resident birds, the reduction cull was taken during the summer, early autumn months when the Icelandic birds were not present. And Orkney farmers worked hard, but could not reduce the number of resident grey lag birds using traditional methods. They managed almost to contain the numbers to between 20,000 and 25,000 birds, but they weren't able to reduce the numbers And so over the last 2-3 years, we've worked with Orkney farmers to see if we can use corralling as an additional control method. And that has worked well. And so the Orkney Local Goose Management Group has put forward a plan to achieve a reduction cull using a combination of traditional methods, shooting, egg oiling, and also using corralling.
Thanks, Morg. I wonder if you could just explain what corralling means.
Thanks. It's a method of taking molt birds that are sitting on lochs, spending time on lochs whilst they're in molt, so they don't fly. They spend time on the lochs, so they have been and they gather together in July, August time on the lochs in molt, and the birds are gently shepherded using kayaks across to take them off the water and onto land, and using sheep pens into a funnel, and then they're dispatched on land.
That's helpful to understand what was actually meant. Can I move to questions from Ariane Burgess, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for being with us. So you may have already answered my question, but I'm going to come at it at a slightly different angle and see what comes out of it. So the Scottish Crofting Federation wrote about the damage that wild geese can cause to high nature value land and world-renowned biodiversity on crofts and farms in crofting areas. So I'd appreciate your professional opinion on how much of the land on crofting areas is high nature value and world-renowned for biodiversity, given that in the Biodiversity Intactness Index, Scotland is sadly 28th from the bottom out of over 200 countries. So that's one part, and then this is the bit where you may have answered it. So I'd also appreciate your opinion on whether further reductions in wild geese populations is the best way to protect and enhance biodiversity in these areas, or if other measures may be either more effective or should be taken alongside goose management programmes.
Who would like to kick off with that one? Morag.
So I just say that we appreciate that crofting is a very important method of supporting, not just delivering not just agriculture and agricultural produce, but also biodiversity. And so healthy crofting systems will support biodiversity. I don't have figures on how on the amount of crofting land and the amount of diversity that it supports with me. Simply, it is really very important in terms of supporting biodiversity and geese are the control of geese is important in terms of helping to keep those crofting systems going, but it's obviously only one of many challenges that crofting faces.
Ray, do you have anything to add to that?
I think, yeah, I agree with Morag that crofting does support a range of biodiversity, and that might be different on different islands and different locations, but it is very much a case that the geese are only one issue, and if we can contribute towards dealing with the goose issue, then hopefully that provides a good contribution to dealing with the kind of wider issues and support that crofting needs. In terms of the sort of national and international kind of importance of biodiversity, we could provide you with some information on designated sites on that. So we can give you areas of MACR or sites designated for bird populations or so on that are important in the crofting areas.
Yeah, that would be helpful.
Yep. That's it. Yeah, that was one. Yep. Thanks.
Before we move to questions from Jenny Minto, Finlay Carson's got a supplementary.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. It's been so long since I've joined remotely, I forgot how to intervene. It's back to the question about corralling. You know, we understand that the estimated population of 1,500 grey lag geese in 2001 increased to 26,500 from 2001 to 2021. It's a massive increase. But my understanding is corralling involves putting them into sheep pens and then injecting them to humanely put them down. What's the cost per goose for doing that? I'll continue with the question because you know that goose is then not fit to go into the food chain or whatever, and the carcasses have got to be disposed of. So can you outline roughly what the cost per bird for corralling and dispatching these geese, and for example, just in Orkney alone?
Ray, do you want to start off with that?
I think that would be Morag's like one. She dealt with the corralling trial, sorry.
Okay, I'll go to Morag. Yeah.
The corralling is expensive compared to traditional methods, and I don't have the exact figures, in the order of £30 per goose for corralling. Overall, the amount of the cost per goose taken over the period that we have supported grey lag control since 2012, the cost per goose has been approximately between £10 and £20 per goose. That's it varies for the different for each of the four different sites, and that's a cost that in that is that's all of the money that has been spent on supporting goose control. So it includes the cost of monitoring, the cost of developing the corralling method, as well as support for shooting, for egg oiling, and for corralling. So yes, the cost of corralling is more expensive than the other methods. But it's been found to be needed on Orkney.
Okay, just on that basis, the fact that only £50,000 put forward to control grey lag geese, and if we're looking at nearly a 25,000 bird increase in Orkney, £50,000 not going to go very far. It's going to be more than spent on Orkney alone, without looking at any islands, other islands on the west coast. So it sort of puts £50,000 into perspective as being a drop in the ocean, and what might be required to control geese numbers.
Yes, can I give you the number of the amount of money that has been spent over the period that we've been supporting grey lag control? So we supported grey lag control since 2012. The demonstration pilots ran from 2012. Until 2017, and then after that, we had hoped that because they were set up as short-term demonstration projects, we'd hoped that local goose groups would be able to control geese themselves, and that hasn't been the case. And funding has continued after that. So, in total, the amount of money that NatureScot and Scottish Government have spent on at these four demonstration sites has been £520,000 to date, and by spring 23, we will have spent the remaining £25,000 of that government support you were talking about there. That would bring the total to £575,000, and I can give you a breakdown of how much was spent at each of the four sites. So by 2023, on UIST, the total will be £209,565. On Orkney, £204,527. £1,000. And then on Tyree and Lewis, where the numbers of geese are smaller, £61,000, £61,312 on Tyree, and £99,926 on Lewis. So it's a bit more than the £50,000 that that the minister offered last February. And I think you were asking me as well about in terms of the cost of the corralling. It's been more expensive because we've been developing that method. So obviously, when you're doing something new, you take extra precautions. And we brought contractors up from England who had experience of using corralling as a method for controlling, particularly Canada geese in parks. But it's part of their work. So we brought up somebody to give advice and to help with the molt survey and to do some of the work. We hope that with the experience we've gained, local people will be able to take on that work and will have developed the skills that are necessary. So in the future, there will be some economies that we can make in that way. And the other thing is, you asked about, you mentioned lethal injection, and certainly we did use that method. And we had vets present to comment on the animal welfare aspects of the work and to make sure that it was done with animal welfare in mind. But we have also found that manual dispatch is also efficient at the corralling. So there are choices to be made, and probably economies to be made in terms of that particular method as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Morag. We've got a supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. It was just to get a little bit more detail on the letter that Patrick Crouse had sent, because I'm not sure if you've seen it, Morag, but in the last paragraph he says that financial support has to be more equitable. For example, Isla Goose Management Scheme has a budget of around £1 million per year, but from the figures that you've just given, that doesn't really equate in my head. So I wonder if you can explain what that budget covered, because you've just talked there about people who are expertise in corralling coming up from England and other methods that possibly needed more expertise. But I mean, just in comparison, he says that used receives zero amount directly from Nature Scots. So it's just how that funding is broken down and how it could be equitable.
The work that I'm describing is about control for resident greylag geese. And then we have ongoing long-term schemes, which are for more highly protected geese. Our Annex 1 under the Birds Directive, where there are more restrictions about more restrictions apply to farmers and crofters in terms of what they can do to protect their crops. And so since 2000, we have supported a range of schemes to help farmers host those birds and to pay for compensation for the impacts that the birds have. So the annual budget for those six schemes at the moment is £1.3 million. So it's completely different in terms of scale. And that's because we've had a direction from Goose Policy, really, to for the National Goose Policy to focus our resources to species of greatest conservation need. So we have a long-term series of schemes to support the management of Annex 1 species, the resident greylag work that we did were relatively small-scale demonstration projects intended to be short-term demonstration projects. So it's different in scale, different in the species and the provisions that we're making through the different schemes.
To continue on that, my colleague Ariane Burgess asked a question there about the high nature value land and the biodiversity. And Morag, you've just mentioned there about looking at the funding depending on, you know, what needs to be protected in terms of that value. You didn't describe it as such, but Patrick Crouse describes it as such. And I just wondered how NatureScot came up with the criteria. Is it based on the number of geese predicted in the count, or is it based on the loss, because you've also said that you pay compensation, the loss of value of the crop, or is it based on the loss of value of biodiversity? And bearing in mind that in your previous answer you said that it wasn't based on high nature value, is there some contradiction there?
The basis for payments are completely different for the two types of support that we give. So the basis for payments for the Annex 1 species is about it fits with state aid. So the money that's given is payment for additional costs incurred and payments for profit foregone, and fits the state aid rules, and money is paid to farmers, to the individuals who are supporting the geese, who are hosting the geese, and that's to support the population of geese and to support the farming that they impact. And the payments that have been made for the adaptive management pilots, the demonstration pilots, are not to individual farmers, they're for a particular activity. They are to support the control of a population and to reduce the size of the population. And the four sites that were selected for those demonstration pilots, they are sites where there were particularly high concentrations of resident greylag geese, high densities. They're sites where the local goose management group applied to join the demonstration projects. There are a couple of local groups who were eligible and who chose not to come into the demonstration project. And the money doesn't go to the individual farmers at all. It goes for the activity of shooting, and it's organised slightly differently in each of the four demonstration pilots. But essentially, the money pays for the coordination of work, linking farmers who want control to happen with shooters who are willing to shoot. On most of the sites, it's volunteer shooters. On Uist, it's mostly through paid marksmen. So it links. So for coordination, for ammunition, and those are the main costs. But it's for an activity, and it goes to meet the costs of delivering that particular activity. It's not a payment to the individual farmers. I may have missed something there, so Ray may wish to add.
No. Sorry, just waiting on my microphone coming back on. I think there's a couple of things to add to that. Is that Morag's describing how we manage greylags as opposed to how we manage protected species such as barnacle geese and green and white-fronted geese. In some of the crofting areas, there are also the £1.3 million budget doesn't all go to Isla. There are six schemes in Isla, Solway, Tyrene Call, Entire and South Walls, and Uist. So there's three crofting areas that we have schemes for managing barnacle geese in the same way as we do on Isla. And they are focused on the areas where barnacle geese are causing serious agricultural damage and the farmers are very limited in what they can do to air and manage those geese. So there's quite a big difference in terms of greylags can be shot these days all year round, and they are a quarry species in the winter and they're on a general licence the rest of the year. So farmers can shoot them to prevent damage. With protected species, it's much more difficult for them to do that, hence the difference in the two approaches. And you know, it's not just Isla that gets the kind of larger payments for barnacle geese. Recall, Uist and South Walls are all within crofting areas, and the areas there that are intensively managed tend to attract the barnacle geese, and there are payments made to farmers on the same similar basis to those on Isla.
Thank you, Ray. Can we move now to questions from Jenny Minto?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Ray and Moira for joining us. I, like Alistair Allen, have a constituency that's impacted by the geese, with both Isla and Tyree sitting in my constituency, and Ray and I often meet on Kilhoman Beach while walking our dogs, and I can attest to the number of seabirds that were sadly washed up on Isla's shores during the bird flu situation. Morag, in your answers to my colleague Rachel Hamilton, you've gone into some of the questions that I was hoping to ask. I'm interested to hear about the differences, because I think, as you've both said, not every situation is the same across the four pilot areas. So what are the major differences across the four pilot areas? And also, what have you learnt, and also what have the communities learnt from the work that's been done? So Morag, if I start with you.
I think that there's a difference between Orkney and the Western Isles, a big difference in that on Orkney, the resident greylag population of about 25,000 birds, I'm talking rough figures, round figures, is joined by a migratory greylag population of about 47,000 birds. So during the demonstration projects, what we have supported is control of the resident greylag population at a time, mostly during the summer, early autumn, at a time when the migratory birds weren't present. So that meant that every bird shot was a resident bird, and that's really important, because it was the resident birds that are causing particular difficulties by stripping barley crops and flattening the crops and making it difficult to control, difficult to harvest, sorry. But it wasn't possible for the Orkney farmers to reduce the size of the resident population, even though they worked really hard, because there's a much bigger population on Orkney to deal with. And if you compare that to the Western Isles, they have a longer period over which they can control birds. They're not joined by the large numbers of Icelandic birds. So they were able to control birds and to choose the time when they controlled them. They still had particular problems with the resident greylags taking barley and just traditional crofted crops. Their numbers are much smaller. We're looking at fewer than 10,000 birds at each of those sites. So, in round numbers, at the end of the pilots. No, I can give you the numbers. The latest counts were about 3,000 birds on Tyree and Col, 4,000 birds Lewis and Harris, 7,000-8,000 birds on Ewis, as compared to the 24,000 birds on Orkney. And at each of the Western Isles sites during the pilot years, 5 years maximum, the local goose management groups were able to reduce their populations by roughly half. But since COVID, numbers have recovered.
Okay, thank you. And is there anything specifically that you've learnt from these trials about the best way to manage the geese? Because you've talked about the egg oiling and the shooting. And I was also interested, I think there was you commented that some goose management groups decided not to be involved in the pilots. Why was that?
Okay. So, I mean, I think the main things that we learned were that local groups can control resident birds if they take action soon enough, and that leaving it until the numbers have reached Orkney magnitude means that the local farmers have great difficulty in controlling. So act soon, and I have been approached by other groups with issues with grey lags in Caithness and in Speyside recently, and we encourage them to control the birds early. If they have particular problems, they're going to consider control, to do it early. So yes, if they take action early, traditional methods can be successful, but it takes continued effort. If you relax, if you let up, then numbers will recover. And we learnt that numbers could be controlled without jeopardising the population, and local groups could do that. And that they could take meat, take the carcasses and sell them without jeopardising the population. And that was a concern before we allowed that to happen and before we licensed that. So I think those are our main lessons.
Morag, Ray, have you got anything to add to Morag's points?
Yeah, I think I could add some detail on the Isla situation in particular. So the Isla group back in 2012 put in a bid to join the pilot situation. They decided that given the amount of money that was offered and the various constraints that would have been placed on them around numbers and how things were done, they felt that they were better off working themselves to kind of deliver grey lag management. At that point, it was becoming an increasing issue because there was an increased amount of barley grown on Isla. Demand from the distilleries meant that quite a lot of Isla farmers were kind of growing increased areas of barley. So they decided to go it alone with the support of the distilleries to try and manage grey lag. And they were relatively successful in shooting quite a lot of geese. But one of the things that I think we're seeing here now is that the extent of barley is quite significant on Isla in the autumn. Farmers are still shooting a lot of grey lags, and the numbers, right, that work being done are continuing to rise in the autumn. What it looks like to us, because the numbers are very low by the time we get to the spring. We count the grey lags all winter when we're doing the barnacle goose counts. and the numbers decline over the winter, and we're left with around 6,000 birds, sorry, 600 birds in the spring, reduced from around 3,000-4,000 in the autumn. And I think what that's telling us is that the management of greylag on Islay is creating a sink for birds to come in from Northern Ireland, mainland Argyll, Mull, other islands. So the increase in greylag all around is, I think, causing an additional problem for the Islay farmers. So I think they certainly put in a lot of effort to manage the greylags, but if other people in different places don't see a need for management and don't do it, then that can impact. But whilst we're dealing with resident greylag birds, they do move about in the country at key times for key feeding opportunities. So I think that's something kind of, I think, as I say, the Islay farmers have been really, really quite proactive and done a really good job in terms of what they're trying to do, but they have had industry support to do it.
Okay, thank you for that, Ray. If I may, just one final question, which I think I'll direct to you as well. Can you, just for the record, explain the difference between Annex 1 and Annex 2 geese?
These are Birds Directive, European Birds Directive listings. Annex 1 are highly protected and can only be managed and shot under licence, and the licences for very specific reasons, and the one we would be using, so it's for reasons of public health, air safety, and in our case it's to prevent serious agricultural damage. So any licence has to go through quite a rigorous assessment before it can be issued. Annex 2 species are quarry species, so there's a season generally in the winter for shooting of quarry species. So in other times of year, we can and were for greylags issuing licences, same way as we were doing for some barnacle geese in some places. But for the last, I think, 3 years, they've been on the general licence, which means we don't have to ask farmers and crofters to apply for a licence. They can shoot to prevent serious agricultural damage. So it's one of the tools we're trying to put in place to help with the management side of things and to make life a bit easier for people who are suffering damage and need to manage geese.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks. We've got a supplementary from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. It was just on the point that was raised by Morag Milne. I think she was alluding to the licensing of the meat from greylag geese, I think, if I picked her up rightly. Has part of the issue been in the past that I realise that we're never going to sell all the meat that results from the shooting of greylag geese in the short term, but but nonetheless, goose burgers are very nice, I can confirm. Has part of the problem not been that the licensing of the sale of the meat has been done on quite a short term or sporadic basis that doesn't encourage or hasn't encouraged maybe businesses to be able to exploit that market and make something of it?
Yeah, I think that has been an issue. Certainly, we would love for every carcass that's taken to be sold and to be eaten and to be used. And we've tried our best to make it possible for people to sell and to give assurance that that sale will be continued. Whilst we were, whilst the UK was part of the EU, we sought European approval, European Commission approval for our proposals, and they did give us approval on the basis that the take was controlled. It was part of an adaptive management project so that the numbers of birds were known, the numbers that were taken were known, there were regular counts, and the bag that was taken as part of the adaptive management bag was adjusted each year in light of the count data and the impacts that the project was having on the local population. And since Brexit, we have put sale onto our general licence 15, and we allow sale through that. But through the pilot process, we have regularly asked for the EC's approval for what we were doing. So yes, there has been some uncertainty from time to time as to whether it was going to continue, and appreciate that that has been, has possibly had an impact on whether people were able to invest in sale.
Turn now to Jim Fairley and questions about distribution, I believe.
But I'm going to come back to Ray, if that's OK. Thanks very much, convener. Ray, can I come back to you just purely in a practical thought process that went through my head while you were speaking to Jenny Minto? If you've got Annex 1 and Annex 2 birds, I presume they do not fly separately, that they're in the same flock. So how do the shooters make sure that they're shooting Annex 2 only? Are they doing it with rifle or are they doing it with shotgun?
They don't tend to fly in the same flock, and they don't tend to graze mixed up in fields. They can do, but not very often. So where you have different species, they tend to be in different parts of the field. Different species have different preferences for what they're looking for in the field. So barnacle geese like the short green, very improved grass and will graze on that. Grey lags and white fronts, for example, might be grazing in some of the kind of longer, more tussocky grass at times. So, you know, it's not often that they're actually mixed up. The shooting is done while the birds are on the ground. It's not like wildfowling where they're shooting as birds are coming off the roost. So so generally, the species, whilst they can be in the same sort of places and they can mix, generally you can, on the ground, you can see what you're shooting at. And anybody shooting a goose for any reason should be able to see what they're shooting at. They do use shotguns and rifles. Obviously, the choice what type of gun they use is down to the judgment of the marksman or the shooter at the time and whether or not they are able to take a shot that will target only the species they are after. So there are times, I mean, on Isla, where barnacle geese are shot under licence, there are restrictions on shooting at if there are other species in the flock. So, you know, anybody firing a gun needs to know what they're shooting at. Any skilled marksman will know what they're shooting at, and they will be pretty sure of hitting only what they're after.
Okay. Thanks for that clarity. The other thing that shows you my knowledge of geese, despite the fact that I've been bird watching all my life, why is this predominantly an island and a west coast problem? Because I live over the flight path of Loch Leven, heading to grazing grounds for geese in vast numbers, but I have no constituency issues, people contacting me saying we need to get rid of these grey lag geese. Why is there such a particular, and we grow malt and barley in Perthshire, by the way. Why is there no problems in the mainland in the same way as there seems to be in the west coast and the islands?
I think probably mostly what you're seeing around Loch Leven will be pink-footed geese. And surprisingly, despite the fact that they are massively our biggest goose population that comes in, there's, you know, we're talking the tens of thousands for the other geese that come in. We're talking 500,000 pink feet coming into Britain, and, you know, quite a lot of them remaining in Scotland over the winter, and they tend to feed on stubbles. So they come in after the barley's been harvested, and anything like sort of sugar beet down in kind of the southeast of England and so on. So they tend to feed on spent fields, if you like, and don't appear to cause the damage that the geese that are wintering on grass or the resident geese going into the barley. But that's not to say there's not grey lags in different places, increasing in number. And as Morag mentioned, people in Strathspey and Caithness are starting to say they're having problems. Pinkfeet, again, they are a quarry species. There is a lot of interest in goose shooting of pink feet, so farmers can get shooting parties in over the winter. And so for the majority of the time, pink feet are here. They can be managed and scared off and shot and so on. So, you know, again, it's a behavioural thing. In terms of why the West Coast and why the concentrations in the West Coast, for things like barnacle geese, it's very much proximity of salt marsh roosting areas, feeding areas. So up and down the West Coast, you've got quite a lot of some big areas of salt marsh, but even small areas of salt marsh close to improved fields. And that's what they're looking for. And I mean, if you go anywhere along barnacle migration routes in Iceland or with the Svalbard geese northwest Europe, you see something that looks very similar to what we look for in Scotland. So it's to do with habitat, feeding habitat, and proximity of appropriate roosting areas nearby. And obviously, the West Coast has got quite a lot of that sort of thing, whereas the East Coast is a bit different.
Okay, thank you very much. Shows that I didn't recognise grey lags either.
I have a couple of questions, just in terms of where geese populations are found. I'm hearing from constituents in Shetland that they're becoming an increasingly damaging issue. And what was put to me was that they're eating a huge portion of grass needed for pregnant or nursing ewes at an increasing expense to the crofter and farmer. So I wonder, we haven't touched on Shetland at all. I wonder if you can give me an indication of what you know about geese numbers in Shetland. Morag?
I can tell you that when we were looking to start up the grey lag demonstration pilots, we identified places where there was a particularly high density of grey lag geese, high density for the amount of improved farmland that was present. Shetland had one of the highest numbers. So, although our last national census was in 2008, and so those numbers are a bit out of date now, I would certainly expect Shetland to have a high density of resident grey lag geese still. I know that there have been some surveys, some local counts of them. I know that they have had issues with resident grey lag geese. They were offered to join the demonstration pilot and chose not to. Not for any specific reason that I'm aware of. There will have been some, you know, there will have been reasons locally, but I don't know what that was. They simply decided not to. So certainly they have issues. I mean, there are other places with high densities of grey lag geese across Scotland. So although we've had demonstration project in four sites, and people with that experience are asking for continued government support to control grey lag geese, there are other places across Scotland who would also be looking for similar support.
And I mean, I guess that follows on from what you were saying earlier about taking action, you know, and controlling early doors rather than letting it build up and becoming the problem. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think Finlay has a question.
You know, we've heard from the Scottish Crofters Federation that, you know, any reduction in funding, and I quote, this would not only be in terms of degradation of the unique environment created and maintained by macro cropping, but also in the economic and mental well-being of individual crofters. And we mustn't forget the impact on the well-being of those who farm in these areas. But do you have any confidence that the report that's going to be published, or the way forward that's going to be published, will be able to be put in place in time to fund the the spring 2023 culls, which, you know, this we heard back in April it was fast approaching. We're now into November. Do you think the report will allow us to look at the pilots, whatever, and put a workable scheme in place that's going to address the concerns of the crofters?
Pilot sites this, in Lewis and Harris, Ballantyree and Uist all have funding offered from the Minister, and so they will be funded for spring 2023. Other sites don't have any funding. Other sites will be looking for, if they're looking for support, will be looking for the outcome from the National Policy Review. And our Nature Scots role to date has been an enabling one to try and enable farmers and crofters to control resident greylag geese by providing advice and licences and demonstration projects, and to meet that level of extra demand which may be out there, would be a significant departure from current national goose policy, which directs us to focus our resources on the species of greatest conservation need. So we really need to wait for the outcome from the policy review, and certainly early feedback from the people who have been responding to questionnaires indicates that there is a big demand for support for controlling resident greylag geese.
Thank you, Morag. And we have a supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
It's not a supplementary, it's a separate question. Would you like me to ask that?
That's all right.
Yeah. It's a question to Ray. In an earlier answer, you talked about not having a systemic monitoring of I presume that's the count, but I'm not quite sure what you meant by that and if I have that right. So if you could just clarify that. But I wanted to ask you, with the dire threat of avian flu right now and the fact that NatureScot already has a surveillance network set up, is there any plan for NatureScot to merge both of those activities, to monitor what has been effective within the pilot projects for control of migratory birds and the natural death of migratory birds through avian flu? Because in my mind, the two are not mutually exclusive right now.
I think in terms of monitoring, all of our goose plum populations are part of a fairly broad-scale goose and swan monitoring programme, and that will look at census, national census of different species at different time intervals, depending on what we need to know and, you know, how the status may or may not be changing and so on. So the last greylag census, resident greylag census, in Scotland, it was done in 2008. But since then, and as we've been carrying out the adaptive management pilots, there has been annual counts on these sites, on the key sites, so that we can monitor the impacts or otherwise of the pilots. As far as avian flu is concerned, we are currently working on a forward plan. So at the request of Scottish Government, NatureScot have set up a task force, different agencies, and we are pulling together the best information, the best science we've got, the ideas around monitoring and so on. So what we do going forward will be very much part of that plan. And that will cover all species, not just geese, and not just greylag geese. So that's we're getting advice from NatureScot's Scientific Advisory Committee, who are a group of mostly academics, and those are the kind of questions that they have been asked to look at and think about a forward monitoring plan. What they advise, what they recommend, and what we do will absolutely be based on some sort of prioritisation and affordability going forward. But certainly there is the potential for avian influenza to be affecting all goose species. And the more we can pull together to better understand that, the better. So we're still, despite the fact we've been, you know, this current outbreak, if we want to call it that, has really picked up speed last November in Solway. And that was kind of contained to the Solway population. And the cases elsewhere were maybe on a par with what we might expect everywhere else over the winter, apart from Islay. But you know, as we see what's happening and how different populations might be impacted, then we'll kind of work through the prioritisation for monitoring and picking up the data. Hope that answers your question.
Yeah, thank you, Ray. It's really helpful, and I think it would be useful for the committee to understand in our remit what Nature's got take forward in terms of those, plans that you talk about there with the academics.
Yeah, we will be the task force. So whilst Nature's got are leading, it involves Animal Plant Health Agency, Scottish Government, Wildlife Management, and Marine Scotland, RSPB, various other organisations, public health, because obviously there's kind of issues around potential impacts on human health, and then things like environmental health, and what we do about the collection or otherwise of carcasses and so on. So all of that will be pulled together in this forward plan, and I think that the draft of that is due fairly soon. So I think once that's done, we can share that with the committee.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of our questions. Could I thank Ray McKenzie and Morag Milne for their time this morning and their helpful evidence. And before we move to our next item of business, I'd like to invite members to consider next steps. You'll see from the papers that the committee may, for example, wish to await the publication of the 5-yearly review into goose management in Scotland and consider the issue again at this point. Are members happy to agree to this course of action? Thank you. Our second item of business today is consideration of the Rural Support Simplification and Improvement Scotland No. 2 Regulations 2022. I refer members to paper 2 from page 10 of their meeting pack. Do members have any comments on this instrument? No comments. We now move to our final agenda item, which is consideration of a consent notification relating to a UKSI, the Trade in Animals and Related Products, Amendment and Legislative Functions, Regulations 2022. I refer members to pages 3 and 4 from page 17 of their members' pack. Do members have any comments on the notification? No comments. Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notifications being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Content. Thank you. I now formally close the meeting.